is brought to you by Head Start Basketball.
We have a very specific way that we believe in, that we know how to teach. We don't start from scratch each year. And I would say that about 80% of that is not going to change very much. And the other 20%, we're going to adapt and be flexible based on the skills and talents of our players.
Kevin Broderick is in his 15th season as the head men's basketball coach at Nazareth University in Rochester, New York, and his 28th overall as a college head coach, amassing a 448 and 269 overall record through his 27 seasons. Broderick previously was the head coach at Oswego for 13 seasons, where he coached the Lakers to 8 straight winning seasons. Broderick's coaching experience includes 2 seasons as an assistant coach at Canisius College and 1 season each as an assistant at Genesee Community College, LeMoyne College, and Nazareth. At Canisius from 1994 through 1996, Broderick worked under the direction of former Nazareth head coach John Beilein, who had several Division I coaching stints, most recently at the University of Michigan. As a player, Broderick was a 4-year member of Nazareth's basketball team and was team captain as a senior in 1988-89. As the team's starting point guard for 2 seasons, Broderick averaged 7.7 and 8.4 assists per game for his last 2 seasons. He ranks 3rd all-time in career assists at Nazareth with 460.
Hey Hoopheads, I wanted to take a minute to shout out our partners and friends at Dr. Dish Basketball. Their Dr. Dish shooting machines are undoubtedly the most advanced and user-friendly machines on the market. Learn more at drdishbasketball.com and follow their incredible content at Dr. Dish B-Ball on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, and YouTube. Mention the Hoopheads podcast and save an extra $300 on the Dr. Dish Rebel, All-Star, and CT models. Visit drdishbasketball.com for details. That's a great deal, Hoopheads. Get your Dr. Dish shooting machine today.
This is Daniel Ginsberg with U-Train, the number one booking app for basketball trainers, and you're listening to the Hoopheads podcast.
Are you a basketball coach or trainer looking to connect with new clients? U-Train is here to help you manage your business and reach a wider audience. Best of all, it's completely free to use. Simply create a profile, list your services, post pins, and share your free booking website link. You can set your own rates and schedule, and use U-Train to communicate with clients, manage appointments, handle refunds, and collect payments automatically. So why wait? Join U-Train today for free and start reaching new clients. That's U-Train, U-T-R-A-I-N, U-Train. Download today on the App Store and Google Play.
Prepare like the pros with the all-new Fast Draw and Fast Scout. Fast Draw has been the number one play diagramming software for coaches for years. You'll quickly see why Fast Model Sports has the most compelling and intuitive basketball software out there. For a limited time, Fast Model is offering Hoopheads listeners 15% off Fast Draw and Fast Scout. Just use the code HHP15 at checkout to grab your discount, and you'll be on your way to more efficient game prep and improve communication with your team. Fast Model also has new coaching content every week on its blog, plus play and drill diagrams on its playbank. Check out the links in the show notes for more. Fast Model Sports is the best in basketball.
Get ready to take some notes as you listen to this episode with Kevin Broderick, head men's basketball coach at Nazareth University in Rochester, New York.
Hello and welcome to the Hoopheads podcast. It's Mike Klinzing here with my co-host Jason Sunkel tonight, and we are pleased to welcome Kevin Broderick, the head men's basketball coach at Nazareth University. Kevin, welcome to the Hoopheads pod.
Thanks for having me, Mike. Jason, really appreciated your work over the years. Wish I could listen to all of them, but I've listened to a bunch and really appreciate the work you guys do.
Well, thank you for those kind words. We are always appreciative of people who give us praise, because you sit here and sometimes you're talking on the into the microphone and you know that people are out there listening and we're able to see statistics and all that, but it's still nice to hear it directly from somebody who finds value in it. And to that end, we're also excited to have you on the other end here on the microphone to be able to share some of your wisdom and knowledge with our audience. Let's start by going back in time to when you were a kid. Tell me a little bit about some of your first experiences with the game of basketball and what you remember.
Yeah, so I grew up in Fulton, New York, pretty close to Syracuse. I had two brothers, younger brother, older brother, and we were simply just a basketball family and a basketball community. There's a little bit of, sandlot baseball. There's a little bit of it. We didn't have Pop Warner football, dabbled in some other sports, but we were, a basketball family and a lot of CYO basketball. We always went to Catholic school and we had a terrific league starting really as young as third grade. And this was, pre-AAU and all these, some of these events that happen now, but we just had a tremendous amount of opportunity to play and, started playing really young and loved every second of it.
What do you remember about some of your early coaches during that time? Is there anybody that stands out or any lessons that you remember learning from those early coaches during that time?
Yeah, I think I think all the time about just how lucky I've been, which on every stop I've been learned from great coaches. My first coach in third grade, a guy by the name of Nunzi Fischera, which he just loved the game, loved to be in the gym with the kids. It was very low pressure, just learn how to play and enjoy it. And I think that's so important for young people. We just loved to be around him, and there was no yelling and screaming. Let's just enjoy the game. And now when I got to high school and I went to Bishop Cunningham, which is a Catholic school in Oswego, New York, and we were clearly a basketball school, and my graduating class had 26 people, but we had five college basketball players on my team my senior year. And we had a guy by the name of Chuck Bassesi who had never coached before, and a few years before I started, he got the job at Bishop Cunningham, and he was one of the great players of from Syracuse. They had a parochial league in Syracuse. He's one of the great players of all time, and he learned how to coach, but right away he knew how to compete, and there was an intensity with everything we did. And I was lucky enough my senior year we won the state title. We won our last 18 games, and it was everything you'd hope to get out of a high school career. And as I said, it was a tiny school, and five of my teammates played college basketball, which is just so unusual.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible. I mean, 26 kids. So how many of those were boys? Was it half and half?
Yeah, we joked. It was all about five or six families with a lot of kids, but it was clearly a basketball school. It wasn't, I played a little bit of football, but in a Class D small school, we didn't have, we didn't have enough numbers to be good in football, but, it was a tremendous, even back in the 50s and 60s, it was, a dominant basketball program. So, that's part of why I went there. And it was, basketball was important from day one, and, just to play at a school that basketball mattered and, all of our teammates knew it. What a tremendous experience.
Was that state title your favorite memory, or do you have another one or two that maybe stand out for you?
Yeah. The state title was so, so special because it was, we had won, we had always my junior year, and I didn't play varsity till I was a junior. My brother was the point guard. My brother Sean was the point guard my freshman and sophomore years. I wasn't going to play and sit, so certainly behind my brother. So I didn't even play varsity till my junior year, and we had been, my junior year we had been a second place team. We couldn't get over the top, and I think we had tremendous dedication from the whole team that summer. It was sort of in New York, it's a big deal to get to Glens Falls. Glens Falls is where the state title was. And it was just like, let's get, we get to Glens Falls, which, school had never done it. It seemed a little bit almost unrealistic, but but we really, really worked at it. And, you know, it was the ultimate team, right? We had, as I said, we had five college players, you know, everybody could play. You know, we had beat a team in the state title called Bridgehampton from Long Island that basically won it every year. And it was a double overtime game. And, you know, the whole school was there. And it just does not get any better than that.
Be able to have that memory. I mean, there's obviously lots of people that get an opportunity to play college basketball at some level, but the number of players that get an opportunity to win a state championship, it's pretty special. And, you know, I think that when you start thinking about those kinds of memories and doing it with guys that, as you said, you guys are all, I'm sure, in the same classes every day together. Yeah. You're playing together, you're friends. And to me, I think that there's nothing better than that state championship as a high school player, just because of, again, that camaraderie that you kind of feel with your teammates. You still stay in touch with those guys?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. And, you know, it was a great lesson, because we knew that we won because we were a great team with, you know, we understood the value of team. Nobody really cared who got the credit. We just wanted to win. And, you know, there's a, you know, there's lifelong memories, and we don't even have to talk about it enough. We just sort of know when we get together that, you know, our school since closed, you know, a few years later, you know, just because of enrollment, it closed. But, you know, that doesn't stop us from connecting. And, you know, we just know. And it was hard fought, well earned. And, you know, it was, you know, extremely, there's no memory I have as a player better than that.
What about college basketball? When did that get on your radar as far as thinking about, hey, maybe I have a chance to play at the college level? Was that something that you dreamed about growing up? Was that something that came to you a little bit later when you were in high school? Just what was your thought process?
Well, I wanted to be the quarterback at Notre Dame when I grew up, but I quickly learned that was zero chance, right? You know, and again, winning that state championship pre AAU, I mean, this is 1985. There was very, very little AAU or exposure camps. And we, the players on our team, especially me, got the benefit of, hey, you keep winning and more people see you and you get more opportunity. And, you know, it's funny. I knew about Nazareth as a junior and senior, and, you know, it was everything I was looking for. I thought, small school, Catholic school, tremendous basketball tradition, even though they'd only had basketball for 7 or 8 years and they'd only had men at the school that long, but immediately they were good. And it was funny, my senior year, I got to coach eventually both at Oswego and Nazareth, but I went to a game. You know, my high school was in Oswego. I went to a game. It was Oswego State against Nazareth. And I knew some of Nazareth's players, but I'd never seen them play. And the game ended, they didn't finish the game. There was a fight. Nazareth was winning. There was a fight, 54 seconds. They never finished the game. So I don't know who won the fight, but Nazareth won the game. And, there was two takeaways I had leaving that game. Number one, it was, you know, there was a precision and a togetherness and a, just the way basketball is supposed to be played, that Nazareth exemplified. And I was like, that I want to play there. But the second takeaway was, you know, I watched Jeff Van Gundy was the point guard on that team. And I remember saying to one of my brothers, right, if that's what a Division III point guard looks like, you know, I've played my last game, because that's that's not my level. And, you know, luckily I learned that, you know, Jeff was an All-American caliber point guard, and he wasn't the norm. So, you know, my high school coach did a great job of telling Nazareth, hey, you know, this, come see this kid play. He wants your school. And, you know, because we won and, you know, got to the state title, they, you know, Nazareth, again, it was a 2 years removed from being an Elite Eight team. They were in the early 80s. They were one of the very few schools that were just recruiting so intensely across the state. And for a while, I think I was the only guy they weren't recruiting. But thanks to my high school coach, you know, they did come recruit me. And, you know, I just, you know, I visited and I was, it was just the perfect place. So, you know, they were coming off, you know, 21 seasons, Elite Eight 2 years ago. So I did not play hardly at all my first 2 years. And I didn't deserve to play. I was on teams that won 45 games in 2 years. And we, at the time, you know, Potsdam was, you know, winning national titles. So the way the NCAA was, we always had to go to Potsdam to play the East Regional. And it was really hard to get out of that. And, you know, both years we lost at Potsdam. But, you know, we were an NCAA tournament team. And then my last 2 years, you know, I got a chance to compete a lot. And it was, you know, it was the perfect place for me. And again, another place like my high school where basketball mattered. It was important to the school. It was important to everybody. And I played for two great coaches, Bill Nelson, who I played for my first year, and he went on to coach the next 23 years at Johns Hopkins, his terrific coach. Then Mike Daly, I played for 3 years, who, you know, just coaches I admired, respected. You know, they were everything the coaching should be about. So I couldn't have got any luckier at Nazareth.
What were you thinking about academically in terms of a career? Was coaching already something that you were thinking about at this point, or were you trying to maybe go a different direction?
You know, I knew that, you know, deep down, I knew I'd always want to coach. And I was a little bit afraid to, you know, I didn't know anybody who did it other than my college coach that did it full time. Or I didn't at first recognize that it was really a career that you could do full time. And I wasn't sure early on that's what I wanted to do. I knew I wanted to coach and teach maybe high school. And, you know, so I got a teaching degree and, you know, student taught and, you know, liked that. But, you know, knew always. I know I remember my senior year just really understanding pretty early. I don't know what I'm going to do with myself when this is done, right? I don't have a lot of other hobbies. And, you know, I knew I would want to coach. I just wasn't sure, you know, doing it for a living. I honestly, you know, I knew that it wasn't the easiest way to make a living. So that part scared me at first to be full time with it.
So when you graduate, what's the job search process look like? What are the conversations you're having with your parents? Just where's your mindset as you're graduating?
Yeah. You know, I was actually had got a degree in business education. So I had a business degree. I had an education degree. I was, you know, towards by the end of graduation, I was, even, you know, really struggling with Coach Daly, who was, you know, if you were to speak with anybody in upstate New York, you know, Mike Daly is you know, maybe the classiest coach and the most honest. And I trusted him with, you know, with everything. And so I was constantly that senior year at the end in his office. And he had helped me get an opportunity to go to grad school at, you know, graduate assistant at Division I Niagara. And I thought long and hard about that. But in the end, I decided to basically be a graduate assistant for Coach Daly. I just, you know, I thought he was a great coach, and he was. And I just, you know, he meant so much to me. I just wanted to be around him and learn. So I started there. You know, I was in grad school, you know, looking at a teaching career. I also got, you know, a master's in counseling and moved into, I was a guidance counselor for a year. So there's a few years of just coaching on the side, thinking I didn't want to do it full time, but eventually I just decided I got to do this full time.
What was the transition like going from being a player under Coach Daly to being an assistant coach with him? I know that's one of the things that I like to, it's a question I like to ask, just because I think when you describe your relationship player coach, it obviously changes when it becomes coach. And I always think that for guys that make that transition, obviously the head coach has to do a good job of facilitating that and making sure that the former player, now coach, feels comfortable. And then I think also it takes a little bit of self-confidence as the player transitioning to a coach. Right. So how did you guys approach that part of the relationship to change from player coach to coach.
Yeah. And first of all, it was, I think as a player, as soon as you become a coach, you realize, even though, hey, I played here for 4 years, you realize, number one, that you really don't know anything about coaching, even though you played here, right? I had a steep learning curve there. And you know a little bit about the game, but I didn't know what really being a coach meant. I didn't understand. I knew Coach Daly was always in there working, and he was always prepared for every practice and game, but you know, I really had no idea all the things he was getting done in a day. And then there was obviously a little bit of an adjustment that, you know, these guys had just been my teammates. So it was that right away always has an adjustment. And, you know, Coach Daly helped me understand that, you know, that means you can't right away be, too on guys and yelling at them, but there's still a role for helping them get better and, you know, being part of it. And again, I was just, you know, I did know, I certainly knew that I had a lot to learn. And, I was very thankful that, in the end, the level didn't matter to me, you know, going Division I. I knew that if I started my career with Coach Daly and, you know, what I learned would be the right things.
That year sort of cement for you that college, if you were going to stay in coaching, that college is where you wanted to be, as opposed to maybe juxtaposing that with your experience as a student teacher and thinking about spending your days in a classroom and then just coaching after school. How did you think about that?
Well, I knew I wanted to do it full time, but there wasn't a million full-time assistant jobs out there and to make full-time money. And, you know, I kind of made the decision to, finish my master's and get, you know, I was a guidance counselor and coaching on the side. And so that was sort of an economical decision, but, you know, and that's, you know, that's a very challenging job, which I learned every day, but I also learned that I just could not, I could not be really happy unless, say, I'm in the gym all day. I'm a coach. And so, you know, I had been with Coach Daly for a year. I had been a part-time assistant, while being a guidance counselor at LeMoyne with John Beilein. And then at one point I just made the decision, hey, I got to pursue some full-time opportunities and give myself an opportunity to do this full-time. It was, you take a pay cut. By that time I knew some of the hard parts of the job, but I also knew the good parts of the job. And it took a few years of that for me to say, okay, I'm all in. I got to figure out how I can do this. And I'm glad I did.
Once you make that decision, how does that change the way that you pursue the next opportunity? Does it just, how does it motivate you? What do you do maybe differently in terms of just thinking about the way that you pursued that next opportunity?
Yeah. And I was, basically at the time I had been, with Coach Daly at Division III, I had been with John Beilein, which was a tremendous opportunity. As a young guy that, a part-time assistant, given scholarships at the high level working for John Beilein, but it was part-time. So I just made the decision, hey, if I can get a full-time opportunity at the level doesn't matter, but what matters is, who do you get, is it full-time and who do you get to learn from? And I caught a huge break because, Bill Van Gundy, who was, Jeff and Stan's dad, who was a long time, he had been a Division III coach. He had a lifer in coaching, and, he had a full-time spot at junior college, Genesee Community College. And, I was just getting married at that time, and it was my wife, Jennifer, who had, been a student athlete at Nazareth too. And she was from Rochester. It was the right location, the right place. And that's a move that I, you know, I'm so thankful for, because working, and it was only 1 year, but working for Bill Van Gundy was just, you know, a life-changing thing for me. And every, you know, he spent so much time saying, hey, this is what it means to be a coach. This is what you are expected to do. And anybody who knows Bill, there's no gray area. He's going to tell you exactly what you're supposed to do and evaluate it. And it was exactly what I needed as a young coach. And it was life changing.
What are one or two things that he taught you during that year that you still carry with you to this day? Things that maybe you can still hear him saying or sharing with you, or maybe a moment that brought those things to life for you. Can you think of anything that fits that description?
Yeah, I mean, there's two that quickly come to mind. You know, one of the first things he said to me as a young coach, and then he demonstrated every day. He said, and I think about this every day when I put a practice plan together. He said, "You don't coach for coaches, right? You coach for players." And you know, maybe as a young coach, you know, you're thinking, "Hey, I want to run a pretty offense or be, you know, have other coaches impressed with my work." And you know, he said, you spend every day thinking about, hey, what does this particular group of players need, this team needs, and that's your focus, and that's the end. And he lived that, you know, at junior college. Sometimes we'd have the guys for 1 year or two, and you know, there wasn't time to develop like a 4-year school was, and he was so masterful at you know, the efficiency of every second, and you know, simplifying the game so people could play, you know, fast and worry free, and then the, you know, how he held them accountable to get better. And I mean, I think about that every day. And he didn't just say it; he demonstrated. And the second thing, you know, when you think about a guy that respects our profession and really, you know, believes in the coaching profession, believes there's a right way to coach. One thing, and I didn't realize at the time how significant this was, and I think about it all the time now, is that so I'm with him for 1 year, and we're playing a very hotly contested game on the road against a team that you know, was really good, and it was somewhat of a rivalry and always a hard game. And, you know, they had somewhat of a volatile coach, and it was about a tie game with about 8 minutes to go. And we made like 5 plays in a row and, you know, started to pull away, started to control the game. And, you know, the other coach thought maybe he was getting the you know, not a fair shake from the officials. And, you know, this guy was way, way bigger than Bill Van Gundy. And, you know, Bill had had some health issues. And all of a sudden, he is storming the referee. He's, you know, left his bench. He'd crossed half. He's full sprint. And I remember in the split second thinking, you know, good, this'll seal this win. This is, and you know, Bill immediately sprinted out there, bear hugged this guy and said, "You don't want to do this. You don't want to do this," right? And, you know, totally calmed him down, situation over. I really think that if he hadn't done that, it would have been really ugly. And I remember thinking, you know, we win the game, and I didn't think about it that much. And about 2 years later, that coach, you know, he got a Division I job. And I'm thinking, that doesn't happen if Bill doesn't do that. And that was so consistent with how he operated. And it was about the game. And, you know, he literally in that split second was thinking about a coach's career. And he's as competitive as they come. But that's what he was thinking. I don't know too many other people that would think like that. And, you know, I've had, you know, it's been 30 some years since I worked with him, but probably once a week or once every couple weeks, I'm calling him saying, "Coach, help me with this." You know, 2 days ago it was, you know, our ball screen defense, right? So it's, yeah, it was life changing to work for Bill.
Let me ask you the same question about Beilein. What are some things that you think back that you learned from him?
Yeah, I can remember thinking when I was with him as a young coach at LeMoyne and nobody had heard of John Beilein outside of Syracuse yet, right? He wasn't a national name and a Hall of Fame coach yet like he is. And I remember thinking, there is no way there can be that many people out there that can do it as efficiently, as good as he can. And, you know, when I left working for Bill Van Gundy, I also got 2 years with John as his assistant at Canisius. And, you know, obviously, you know, his ability to teach, you know, such a master of teaching the fundamentals. You know, one of the things that always inspired me as a coach is that he was so motivated to do everything a little bit better. He loved to go watch high school recruits at practice, and he'd always come back from practice like excited, saying, "Hey, you know what? This high school team did the shooting drill a little bit better than we did. They get 10 more shots off in a minute than we do. So we're going to do that." And he was always doing that. And, you know, I don't think I've ever sat with him, you know, when I was with him for 3 years at a restaurant, where he didn't pull a handful of change out of his pocket and put it on the table and start moving it around in X's and O's. He never stopped. And the other thing, you know, John was, and I share this with my team every year, you know, John was, most of his career at LeMoyne, was the compliance coordinator, right? And, you know, I think in 2017, I think it was, Sports Illustrated did a poll, and there's 400 some Division I coaches. So it's a ballot with 400 people you could vote for the cleanest coach in college basketball. And John got 26% of the vote when you could vote for 400 people. And again, that when I worked with him, that was very consistent with how he operated. He wanted to know every NCAA rule, not so he could find a way around it, so that he could protect his team and his school. And, you know, that was a lesson every day. We spent, certainly at Canisius, every day there was some discussion about how do we do this and not, you know, break an NCAA rule. And you would see with the 20-hour rule that all of a sudden somebody would say, "Hey, coach, your 20 hours is up," and he had 5 minutes left in practice, we'd be out of there. That's, you know, what a great example for young coaches.
When did you start to think that you were going to maybe be ready to look for a head coaching job? Was there a moment that it struck you that, hey, I think I'm ready to start looking and maybe go on some interviews and see if I can't get a job? Or was it something that kind of built up gradually?
Yeah, when I worked for John Beilein the second time at Canisius, and we had three assistants, you know, Mike McDonald, who's now the coach at Dame and a great coach, and, you know, Phil Seymour, you know, was a terrific coach. And, you know, so I was the third guy. And I think all of us, you know, and I had replaced one of my best friends in coaching, Dave Nyland. And I think all of us who worked for John understood that, you know, he was never an assistant coach. He learned by doing, you know, he's a high school coach, a junior college coach. And, you know, before he got a chance at Division I, he had already won 250 games as a head coach. So he always impressed upon us the importance of, hey, that to really develop as a coach, you got to get your own team and make your own decisions. So early on, we all had that mind frame. And, you know, I had played Division III. I loved Division III. And so I was very comfortable starting to look for Division III. I loved working for John in Division I, but I was, after 2 years there, I think I was 27, I was dying to have my own team. And, you know, the Oswego State job opened. It, being from Oswego, they just hadn't had a lot of success. Most of the time they had part-time head coaches, you know, some good coaches, but really hard to do it part-time. And so because they advertised it first as a part-time spot, I didn't have to beat out a million people, but so I just didn't. And I got that job, and I was there a week, and they made me full-time and in the admissions office. And then the next year I was a full-time coach. So, and having lived there and grown up there, I knew it was a great school. I knew it was a place kids like to go to. I knew it was a good job. So, I mean, I wasn't afraid to take it part-time. I don't know how ready I was, but I was dying for that opportunity. And, you know, again, I think that maybe if it was a full-time position, I probably wouldn't have got it.
What was the learning curve like in terms of game management? Because up until this point, basically your entire career, you've been an assistant. And when you slide over on the bench and now you're making those in-game decisions, I mean, there's a ton of decisions that came well before you played a game. But just thinking about the game reps that maybe you didn't have as many coming in because, again, you had been sitting in the assistant chair. So what do you remember about the learning curve as far as game management?
Yeah, and I think I was like so excited to get the job, and thought I had a pretty good plan. But I think looking back, and I know that I knew exactly how I wanted to coach defense. I knew it's with Coach Van Gundy, and it was all half court man to man, no zone, simple rules. Stressing, intense play. And I just knew exactly how I wanted to play defense. And I thought I really didn't have a good enough plan with offense. If you're a John Beilein disciple, that, this two guard offense, which frankly, it was so complicated. I think that's why it wasn't complicated for John, or it wasn't complicated for the players, but back then, he hated to write it down. He was worried about people, stealing it. And it was so hard with John to keep up with him day to day. And it was his offense, and it was so good. And, everything about the fundamentals of the offense and the pivoting and the spacing and so much of that I copy every day. I just didn't think that, at Oswego at the time, we were definitely going to have some junior college players, which we only had them for 2 years. And it just felt like even for a masterful teacher like John, it took a while. So I guess being impatient. So I just didn't think I could do that and implement that. So it just took me a full year to really decide how I wanted to play on offense. And obviously we all evolved with that, but I sort of cheated that first team on that end of it. And, I don't think I've ever gone into a season since then without really having a very specific plan of how we want to play at both ends of the floor. So I had half of it, but not the offensive end.
So. What does that year-to-year planning process look like for you when one season ends and you look at who you got coming back, you look at guys you're bringing in, and clearly you have a way that you like to play, but some of that has to be dictated by who the players are that you have on your roster. So what's that process look like?
Well, and again, I did sort of copy from John that, being a system coach that, hey, we have a very specific way that we believe in that, we know how to teach. We don't start from scratch each year. And I would say that, about 80% of that is not going to change very much. And the other 20%, we're going to adapt and, be flexible based on, the skills and talents of our players. I think this system is flexible enough that, hey, if the best player this year is a point guard, well, we can emphasize that. If the next year it's a post player. But I think, and John was really big on this, is that, you can't procrastinate to implement what you want and, wait around and see who can do what with all of it. So, we start every year, certainly with a lot of off-season planning, but, and we get to recruit to our system. So there's not certainly part of it has to change, but, we're not going to start over every year. And, You know, Bill Van Gundy always talked to me about that, you know, predictable is not always a bad thing, right? Is that, you know, my biggest focus is, hey, do the Nazareth players know what we're about and what we're supposed to do? And, you know, we'll worry next if our opponent knows.
Funny that you say that, because that's one of the things that when I was a high school varsity assistant, I always felt like that was the key to our team's success, was how well could we execute what we were supposed to do. And right. I always felt like and this is coming off me as a player and thinking back, and clearly, like, I played, I'm just a couple years younger than you, so we played in sort of the same era where, I don't know what your scouting reports look like in college, but, you know, mine were pretty basic, and there wasn't a ton when I look back on it and think, and I'm sure our coaching staff put a ton of work in it, but when I think about how much of that I actually processed and utilized while I was playing, I mean, there was some, but probably not that much. And then I got to high school and I'm coaching, and I know the level of players that we were coaching compared to the level of players that I was playing with when I was playing. I'm like, man, if the guys that I was playing with and myself, if we didn't take a whole lot of value from the scouting report, like these high school kids, they're just not getting very much. And I always felt like if we can just get good at what we do, that in a lot of cases, you know, once you got beyond your first like five or six guys, like you were lucky if guys seven or eight knew your plays, let alone could try to figure out something that somebody else was doing. And so I always kind of felt like, let's just get really good at what we do. And if we do that, yeah, we can maybe give them a little bit, but you know, it's just, and I think sometimes it's interesting that obviously it's so much different now because the scouting process and the way kids can watch film and share and do all the things that where you and I were sitting in a film room where a coach was trying to hit rewind on that VCR button and going 15 plays past the one that they wanted to show. And just, you know, it was a mess compared to what we have now. But I think that's really a good point is, hey, you got to get good at what you do.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I one of the things, you know, Jeff Van Gundy, who's a Naz alum and just been so, so helpful to our program and to me and all the coaches. And, you know, he, you know, one of his great lines one time was, you know, in this world of everybody wants to think outside the box, the answers are oftentimes in the box, right? And the, you know, what wins to me for 28 years of coaching as a head coach, it just hasn't changed, right? And, you know, there's, you know, certainly advancements and you know, all this. You know, I remind my sons who are just starting coaching that they can go on YouTube and find the best, you know, 10 international plays or the best 10 NBA plays that were run last night. And, you know, certainly as a starting coach, we didn't have any access to that. And, you know, there's a lot of tremendous parts of that that can help you and your playbook and your diversity of what you do. But at the end of the day, I don't think, you know, most of our guys, it's you know, they're going to give it the right amount of attention. But you know, I was reminding our assistants the other day, last year we had five members of our team that, you know, they're pursuing doctorate degrees right now, right? They're going to give us 2 hours every night, but they're not going to go home and watch 2 hours of film. And I don't expect them to. So, you know, being complicated or that's just not our priority. And I don't, you know, I just, again, I think a lot of that's overrated, and I just feel awful if I contribute to losing by asking our guys to do something we just simply have not repped enough. You know, that's bad coaching, and we're going to err on the side of just not having enough in our playbook versus, hey, we're trying something that we just didn't get enough reps at.
Is that something that you have grown to understand better as a head coach from when you first started? And I guess to go along with that question, in addition to answering that little part, but are there other things too that when you think about where you started compared to where you are now, what are some areas that you feel like you've gotten way better at, or maybe some things that you thought were, you know, that are different than what you thought when you first became a head coach in terms of importance?
Well, you know, again, as I mentioned, I think it's, you know, so important to have a philosophy with every part of the game, offense, defense, special situations. And so, again, I think when I started as a head coach, I had a really good plan defensively, but had to dig deep and had to learn the hard way with, frankly, offense is harder to coach. And so that took me a little while. I think, too, that if I started my career over the first few years, it was, that balance between the coaching intensity and, trying to win the game, just playing harder than the other team versus, let's just be more fundamental, right? The last 15 years of my coaching career, I've given the fundamental piece, the attention it deserved. You know, as a young coach, I thought we could out hustle our way to to wins, and which obviously there's a place for that. But I think, as you go through winning and losing, that usually when you lose, it usually comes back to, hey, we got to get better at pivoting, we got to get better at closing out, we got to get better at talking through switches. And I think early on I didn't, it was a little bit skewed in terms of effort, which matters, but now it's, a lot of attention to, let's win the fundamental battle.
Your first impression is everything when applying for a new coaching job. A professional coaching portfolio is the tool that highlights your coaching achievements and philosophies, and most of all, helps separate you and your abilities from the other applicants. The Coaching Portfolio Guide is an instructional membership-based website that helps you develop a personalized portfolio. Each section of the Portfolio Guide provides detailed instructions on how to organize your portfolio in a professional manner. The guide also provides sample documents for each section of your portfolio that you can copy, modify, and add to your personal portfolio. As a Hoopheads Pod listener, you can get your Coaching Portfolio Guide for just $25. Visit coachingportfolioguide.com/hoopheads to learn more.
Talk about the decision to leave Oswego and take the job at Nazareth. Obviously, it's your alma mater, so clearly there's a pull, a tug there. But just you had a tremendous amount of success at Oswego. Was it strictly the opportunity to, quote, come back home, or what was it about the Nazareth job that made you want to leave a place that obviously you had a tremendous amount of success?
Yeah, it was excruciating in terms of how hard a decision it was. And I'm reminded every day that there's a ton of good, very good coaches who don't get a chance to coach Division III at one school. So it sounds awful to say it was hard to choose between two great jobs, but I loved Oswego. I was 13 years. I loved every part of it. My wife still works there, and she is a tremendous school. We had tremendous leadership. As you can see that they just, they're ranked third in the country right now. In the preseason, Adam Stockwell took over and, did a very good job. And then Jason's taken it to a whole new level. It's a great place. And Nazareth was really the only Division III job. And it was, the pull of my alma mater, my wife's alma mater, but also my three sons. And they were only in sixth grade, fourth grade at the time. But deep down, we knew that they'd be the type of guys that would love to go to college in Nazareth. We believe that. And all three of them ended up going there, and, you get that free tuition. And, so I really underestimated how hard it was because, we just come off a good season. I loved my players. I underestimated how hard it would be to leave those guys that, we had, really worked at it as 13 years. And that last group, I really didn't handle it well at first. And, somebody finally made me, hey, at least you got a new team to embrace. And, Coach Daly had left me a very good team with a with an All-American, Corey McAdam. So it was very, very hard. But, you know, I do think I get to coach at the best place in the country for me. So I guess I shouldn't say it was that hard.
When you get the job, clearly it's very, very important to you just because it's your career and you've just made a decision. But you have, I think, whenever you're an alum at a school, I just feel like there's whatever, there's just a tiny little extra ounce of something that you pour into it just because that place has been so good to you and meant so much to you. Yeah. So when you first took over, what was something that you thought, we've got to get this done in order to get the program exactly where I want it to go? Were there one or two things that stood out to you that you thought, man, if we can just get a handle on this, we're really going to take this program where I want it to go?
Yeah. And it was, you know, for me, a lot different than my first opportunity at Oswego. I was taking over a program that, you know, had been successful and had, you know, a longstanding coach. You know, Coach Daly was there 23 years and had had so many good things in place. And, you know, certainly, hey, as coaches, we have to, you know, I had learned so much from Coach Daly, but you know, you have to do your thing and you have to do what you believe in. And, you know, number one, you know, I wanted to, you know, establish, you know, a toughness and intensity that, you know, I thought could be better. Number two, I wanted to embrace, you know, there were so many players over the years that had great pride in Nazareth basketball. And, you know, I wanted to, you know, get them on board. It was certainly a priority for me to have somebody like Jeff, who wasn't just Jeff Van Gundy, not just a great former player, but, you know, for, you know, our opinion, you know, maybe the best coach out there, that, you know, we wanted to get him connected to our players. And I knew as a player, everything he stood for. And, you know, we wanted to, hey, this is, you know, number one, this is very, very important, right? Nazareth basketball is, you know, you're now playing for somebody who played here, and it is extremely important. Nobody believes in the school more than me. And, you know, we're going to take great pride in our school.
Getting Jeff back involved, an easy sell for him?
You know, it was. It certainly was, because one, he had a great experience. He had, you know, had been at, you know, three other schools. He started his career at Yale. You know, again, he was a great player. And, you know, and then he had played for his dad, who was at Brockport State. And, you know, when he came to Nazareth, he would say, I think he just said this the other day, and he enjoyed his experience everywhere else, but he found a home. And, you know, his junior year, they made the Elite Eight. And, you know, it was great basketball. We had, you know, Coach Nelson had already established a great program. So he loved his experience in Nazareth. So it was not hard. I had built some relationship with him, having worked for Bill, but, you know, certainly it was easier that he wasn't coaching an NBA team at the time. And so he had, you know, time, and it's just been so, so beneficial to our players. You know, and then when we discovered Zoom, right, the amount of time he spent with our players, you know, through Zoom. He lives in Houston, but just spends time with everything you would hope somebody would tell your players, right? And everything he's about as a coach, and he was about as a player. And I think 2 years ago, we had won like 16 or 17 games in a row. And right before the end of the season, I think we lost 3 out of 5. And we very simply, you know, we had lost our mojo. Like, we were just not playing with confidence, and the conference tournament was coming up. And, you know, I don't think I'd do this with anybody else. And I was like, Jeff, we just talk to these guys. And, you know, he watches the games, he follows the team, he knew. And somehow he got it, helped get across to our guys, you know what, let's just play, let the coaches do the worrying, and you guys just compete. And, you know, he knew our guys, and he would say things like, hey, if, you know, Steve, if you're not going to defensive rebound better, we're not going to win. And the players knew that. He watched the games. He was invested. And, you know, we end up winning our conference tournament and winning a game in the NCAAs. And it's just been – it was an easy sell, and it's been such a highlight for me and for – again, for our players. All of our players who are interested in getting into coaching have learned so much from them, him, and he gives them all his cell phone. They reach out, and, yeah, we're – we do whatever we can to have him a part of it, and our players benefit so much, and the coaches do too, obviously.
What's some of the feedback you hear from players? Obviously, it's not an everyday experience that you go and play basketball at a Division III school and you get an opportunity to interact with somebody who's had such a tremendous amount of success at the highest level of the game. So what are your players, if somebody stops in and is in the office talking to you, what are some of the things that they've shared with you that Jeff that has had an impact on them in some way?
Yeah, it was funny that you know, as one example, you know, my son who played for me for 5 years actually, you know, he graduated and got his first teaching job. He's teaching middle school, and he got a teaching job at Brockport Middle School, and that's what Jeff went to Brockport High School. And you know, Jeff had impacted him so much. His whole bulletin board in his classroom was, you know, and Jeff Van Gundy's quotes that he had learned over the years. You know? And, you know, I guess the fact that Jeff's an alum, right? He could get away with that too. He's a Brockport alum, but you know, things like, you know, your decisions reveal your priorities, and, you know, things that certainly are appropriate for middle schoolers. And, you know, that's just one example. You know, our guys get so excited about it, and they're so impressed with how invested he is. And, you know, I think an example was when he talked to our team before that tournament 2 years ago. He pointed out to our players, and I should have, but I didn't realize this. He had pointed out to our players that, even though we were 21-6 at the time or something, we were trailing at halftime at 13 games. And he basically got on them for, you know, you guys aren't getting yourselves ready at the tip. And that's a problem. And, you know, really challenged them on that. Number one, they were, you know, that's how invested he is. That's how, you know, and they, you know, they understand that right from the start, that this is not just, you know, well-known guy. He's all in on Nazareth basketball, and they have great appreciation for that. And they love it.
What was it like coaching all your sons? Because obviously that's something that some guys get to do. And a lot of times you get to do it at the high school level, but not everybody gets that opportunity, and you get an opportunity to do it at the college level. So right. There's clearly some really positives to it. And there's also some pitfalls that you got to watch out for. So let's frame it in the sense of what was it like? And then if you had to give somebody else advice for coaching their own kids, what's some things that you guys learned along the way that helped make the experience a positive one?
Yeah, it was, you know, number one, with all of my sons, I, you know, had the opportunity to coach them for multiple years, 5-6 years each in spring AAU. So I like to say that I really screwed it up then when it didn't matter as much, right? It's spring AAU. And I'm glad I did that, because I was a little bit better at being fair when they got with me. You know, all three of them, you know, the number one thing they've made easier on me as a coach's kid is they've always been, you know, in tremendous shape and just ready to go. And, you know, I think that matters, right? One of the first thing we do at October 15th, the first thing we do is, you know, we run the mile, right, to see who's really ready to play and wants to play, and a timed mile. And, you know, my youngest son, you know, he won it for 2 years in a row, which, again, you know, that sort of helps the credibility. But, you know, as far as advice, I would say that I did learn, you know, in fairness, that just because they are the sons of a college basketball coach, and, you know, we certainly talk a lot about the game and fundamentals and strategies at home and it feels like they get, you know, more information and more teaching, that it's still, that doesn't mean they might not turn it over. They might not forget that we don't have any timeouts left, or, you know, they're still going to screw it up, and they shouldn't be held more accountable than the rest of the guys. So I think I screwed that up a bunch, and I really caution when you coach your kids. But I would say, you know, our when we had a great year 2 years ago when we made the second round of the NCAA tournament and, you know, hosted and had the sellout and every, you know, all the greatest experience I've had as a coach, to have all three of them on my team at the same time was incredible. And, you know, included in that year, we played an exhibition game at Notre Dame with all three of them, which we're a hardcore Notre Dame fan. You know, we're huge Notre Dame fans. So that year was special, that we started the year with Notre Dame and ended it with the NCAA tournament, and, you know, all three of them were playing. So that was about as good as it gets.
What was the most challenging part of it?
You know, it was, you know, it was tough that my oldest son, you know, he was always a valuable player, and, you know, he had tore his ACL 1 year, and then he got the COVID year. So essentially he was there 6 years, and every year he was there, he was, you know, he was the backup point guard, and he was an important player every game. He became at 5'7", a disruptive, like almost intimidating defender. He's a great one-on-one defender, and but he, you know, he never rose to the level of being the starting point guard. And that, you know, he was, as a competitor, you know, he wanted that, and, you know, that's not easy to see him not get that goal. But you know, it was always a little bit easier when, hey, he knows he's a valuable guy, and so it worked. But it's certainly not, didn't make it easy. And, you know, my other sons, you know, similar. None of them ever started. They were all great teammates and valuable guys. But, yeah, you know, it's never easy that way.
What do you think, as you look at the success that you've been able to have, and you think about the types of players that you're recruiting,
yeah,
what are some of the intangible things that you look for that you know is going to make a player successful for you at Nazareth?
Yeah, and we've had, you know, so much fun the last 4 or 5 years, because we really have had, you know, great teammates. And again, I've certainly coached enough years where that wasn't true. And I think especially the last 10 or 15 years, you know, every time we start the recruiting process, you know, number one, we're calling the high school coach. I'm blown away that I hear these, you know, a high school coach tell me that, you know, somebody's recruiting their kid and they've never heard from that school. I mean, that's, you know, that's call number one, the high school coach. And it's always, we always start with two questions. One, you know, what type of teammate is he? And two, what would the rest of the kids at his high school that aren't his teammates say about him? And the answer to those two questions are very important to us. And, you know, I think, you know, when I first started coaching, I didn't think about that enough. You know, maybe you thought you could change a guy who wasn't a great teammate. I don't think that anymore. I tell our assistants, hey, we're just like, our obligation is to make guys better at pivoting and better at defending. We should be able to make them a better teammate, but we're not deprogramming them. We're not going from bad to good. We're going from good to better. So that really has worked for us. And, you know, I think the third thing that some of my great players that I've coached have taught me and reemphasized to me is that, you know, the compete level, you know, Jeff used to remind, he's reminded me more than once, is don't confuse, you know, the hardest worker with most competitive. They're two different things, and you'd like to have both, but the most competitive is probably the most important. So we're really interested in you know, how they compete. Does their high school team win? Can they not live with their high school team not winning? And are they, you know, does the scoreboard matter a lot to them? And, you know, we really try to evaluate that. And, you know, it's a factor. Hey, if we're going to recruit you, you know, I tell our guys all the time, I have no idea on our team, none, who scored 1,000 points in high school. It's an accomplishment. It's great. Not one I'm that concerned with, but I know if they won a sectional title or a state title, and you know, that matters.
You look at, you mentioned coaching your sons in AAU basketball. We know that sort of the way that players are recruited has shifted. I mean, I remember the first time I ever heard a story like you described of a high school coach telling me that their player had been recruited and the college had never spoken to them as the player's high school coach. It was in the first year, I think, of the podcast. So we're looking back probably in 2018, maybe it was late or maybe it was early 2019. And I remember this coach was a local high school coach here in Cleveland telling me that one of his players signed to go to this school and that he had never talked to the coach. And I remember just being absolutely floored by that. And then as I've been through it, and my son is a senior in high school this year, and you see kind of how the landscape has changed and how it's a lot easier for coaches to go and be at an AAU tournament. You can see a ton of different players, and you can, especially at the Division III level, you can talk to those players, you can talk to their parents, you can talk to their AAU coach and kind of get a feel for it. And with the high school, you maybe go and you can go to a practice or you can go to a game, but you're only seeing one player and it's not quite as time efficient. So how do you think about AAU basketball in terms of evaluating kids and getting a feel for what they can do and compare that to how you recruit at the high school level and what you're seeing? Maybe compare the two in terms of what are you looking for and which one do you, I don't know, prefer, but just how it's changed the way that you look at recruiting.
And, you know, certainly there's great value in both. And, you know, obviously sometimes, you know, AAU gets an unfair, reputation sometimes. It's just like high school. Sometimes there's, you know, bad AAU programs, good AAU program. You know, my assistant, who's a tremendous assistant, Dennis Walker, you know, he ran a great AAU program for a lot of years in Rochester where they practiced three times a week and they did everything that, you know, I wish my son played for them and, you know, everything that you'd expect from, you know, a great program. And so, you know, certainly when it's something like that, that has great value. We're a school that, you know, the early decision, we don't do a lot of that. We don't push kids to decide early. I find great value in watching kids play with their high school team, their senior year, when they should be playing their best basketball. And we've had so many great players that their jump from their junior year to their senior year was significant. And, you know, maybe weren't sure they were recruitable as juniors, but they're playing great when they should be. So we like to go slow with that and evaluate our current team, and fit is so important and timing is so important. And, you know, we are very patient with that. And, you know, again, I think as good as AAU is, I just think that kids should play their best with their high school team, their senior year. And, you know, usually the players we're recruiting, unlike AAU, have on their high school team, they have a lot of responsibility. They have to do a lot of things for their team to win the game. And I like to watch that. And so they both matter, but, you know, certainly I've never recruited a guy without having a long talk with their high school coach. And I find that, you know, and as I said, you know, how they act during the other 22 hours of the day that the high school coach is always so valuable with. So they both matter, but to me, we really, really rely on their evaluating them in high school, and we're not in a hurry. So some of our decisions are not made about who we're really recruiting until December of their senior year.
Makes sense. I mean, again, as you said, you would expect that by the time a kid gets to their senior year, that that's going to be when they're at their best, and you're going to be able to see them at the time that's closest to when they're actually going to enroll in your school and be a right. part of your program. So that completely makes a ton of sense. Obviously, there's different schools that have different requirements and different ways of going about things, but I think that the more careful you can be in your analysis, the more likely it is that you're going to make a good decision and get the right guys to be a part of your program. And then once you have those guys on campus, then you got to build that culture with your team and get them in the right positions and do all the things that we already talked about. How do you think about putting together a practice? What's your philosophy on practice design?
Being an assistant for the great coaches, you know, Coach Beilein, Coach Van Gundy, Coach Daly, that, you know, I saw early on, that was one of the first things I saw as a young coach, the amount of time that those guys would put into, you know, their practice plan. You know, Coach Beilein would, he'd love to walk into practice and tell the team, hey, I hold in my hand the best practice plan ever put together, right? And he took great pride in it. And, you know, he was a teacher. And so I've thought, you know, put a lot of time and thought into how we do that. And, understanding how kids learn can, not everything, but can most of the things we do be fun, challenging, and meaningful, right? The fun one's not always going to be there, but it does matter, you know, that they enjoy it. You know, is every drill challenging and meaningful? And, you know, I would never think to my high school, you know, I know what my answer would have been if I asked my high school coach, why are we doing this, right? It wouldn't have been a pleasant answer, but I think every coach nowadays, you know, you should be able to, whether you want to answer the question or not, you should be able to answer why we do this. And, you know, obviously a lot of thought for us goes into, well, you know, what happens the most in the game, right? Are we given that? And, you know, what's most impactful, you know, to winning the game? And, you know, that has to get a lot of attention. I remember, you know, you asked me about those first year mistakes, and
right.
I remember at Oswego, I just did, I think Coach Beilein had done this, but my plan was always basically mostly defense at the first half of practice, a little bit more offense in the second half of practice. And as a young coach, I was always behind schedule. So the same thing was getting cheated every day. It was always the offense and it showed in how we played. So, you know, you think about that. And I was just telling my assistants the other day, you know, yesterday we had a great practice, right? We had a great practice. We all felt good about it. And with about 20 minutes left in the practice, that well-planned practice, I was like, we're not doing what I had planned the last 20 minutes because we can't get any more out of what we're doing right now. You know, we're playing, you know, really intense, fundamental 5-on-5. So we don't need to do anything else. And this is the way we're going to use our last 20 minutes. So, you know, and that way the practice plan doesn't run me. I run the practice plan, but I'm not, you know, you have to be willing to go off script. But at the same time, you know, it's like a lesson plan, and there has to be a lot of thought into, you know, how the players learn and what happens the most in the game.
It makes total sense. And I think it's interesting that I guess I would echo what you said there in terms of, I think the way that coaching has changed a lot in the 30 years that I've kind of been around it is when you go back to the era, maybe when you and I played, there wasn't a lot of answering. And certainly the question, we didn't ask the question. And many times our coaches didn't provide that why answer to us. Right. I'm sure they had some whys, although I would venture to guess my own experience as a player that sometimes I'm not sure they could give me a why, at least not one that would have been believable back then at the time. But nonetheless, I do think that one of the things that's changed is that coaches are starting to realize more and more, and I hear more coaches saying it, and it only makes sense that we have to do and replicate in practice what we're going to actually see in games. And I think the better coaches have realized that over the last 5 or 10 years where, like, okay, this might be a drill that, wow, it's my favorite drill. I really love this drill, but how does it translate into what we actually do when we're playing a 5-on-5 game for real? And I think there's been a tremendous recognition of that. And part of it is just, like we talked about before we even jumped on today, podcasts, the ability to go on YouTube, the ability to listen and hear other coaches talk about what they're doing. I think just generally speaking that the coaching profession has been opened wide. Like I laughed a little bit when you talked about how, you know, John Beilein didn't want to share anything. He didn't want to write anything down because he didn't want anybody to find out about it. And now it's like every single thing you do is on Synergy 5 minutes after you, you know, after your game ends. So everybody can see, anybody who wants to take the time to break down and try to figure out what you're doing, it's all there for them. So it's hard to, I think, keep secrets, much harder than it was back in the day. But I think ultimately you want to be doing things that your team's going to do in games. And if you're doing that in practice, you're probably running a pretty good practice is kind of where I land on this whole thing.
Right. And it's so, you know, it's so tempting that all these resources and to see a great play one night or hear, you know, see a great, you know, the ability to type in what's the best transition defense drills and, you know, 10 great drills come up. It's so tempting to keep adding, which is probably not the answer. And it's, you know, it's interesting with, I know Coach Beilein would say this. I know Jeff Van Gundy said this. I remember Dean Smith in his book said this, is that the, you know, it seems like the most experienced coaches, if they had it to do over, they'd play more five on five in practice. And so I try to do that. I got my pet drills and favorite drills and my security blanket drills, but that keeps echoing in my ear that those the most successful coaches are saying that.
Absolutely. Completely understand. All right. We are coming up towards almost an hour and a half here, Kevin. Want to give you a chance to share how people can connect with you, find out more about your program. So if you want to share email, website, social media, whatever you feel comfortable with. And then after you do that, I'll jump back in and wrap things up.
Yeah, I'm not the hugest social media guy, but at Naz Basketball on Twitter is a good way to or X, I guess now is a good way to follow our program. Love to hear from coaches and kbroder0@naz.edu on email, and certainly love to connect with coaches, and I appreciate that, you know, guys like, you know, you and Jason do this work, which allows us to do that. So,
well, we're really appreciative of your time. Cannot thank you enough for jumping on with us tonight. It's been a lot of fun learning a little bit more about your program at Nazareth and learning about your journey as a basketball player and a basketball coach. So thank you for your time. And to everyone out there, thanks for listening. And we will catch you on our next episode. Thanks.
Thanks for listening to the Hoopheads podcast presented by Head Start Basketball.